Sponsons, Castle Doctrine, and spending way too much money on video games, we played Battlefield 1 for this week's Roundtable. Welcome to another episode of Tiny Spaceship's Roundtable. This week, we've returned to the Great War with Battlefield 1, a first-person shooter developed by DICE and published by EA, released as of October 21st. Joining me on this week's Roundtable, I have Matthew.
Hello, everybody.
Fighting off an illness, Johnny.
Hello.
Miguel.
Hello.
David.
What's up?
And I am your host, Kevin. So guys, what the hell is Battlefield 1?
Well, it's a team-based squad shooter, and they got several different game modes in there, and I'll go over those now for you here. One of the new modes they have is Operations. It's somewhat similar to Rush. There's two sides, attack and defense, and the attackers have to capture and hold two flags, and when they do that, then the defenders will move back to another point, and it's just over multiple maps. They designed it to be more epic in nature, and they wanted it to be more of a bigger engagement, I guess, and not so bite-sized. Have you guys played much of this mode? I've only played it like once or twice.
It kind of seems like Rush without the bombs.
Yeah,
it's like a mix. It's like if Rush were just a capture based mode.
It seems always like heavily one-sided, so I'm not really a big fan of it.
Maybe I'll try it more later after I get sick of the other modes, but the main mode of the game is still Conquest, and that's, you know, returning from previous games. 64 players, large map, has all the vehicles. It has the new behemoths, which if your team gets behind far enough, they'll give you a super vehicle to use during the match to try to even the odds. In my experience, it doesn't seem to really turn the tide as much, though. I don't think I've ever actually lost to a Titan, a behemoth. It's
that's next week.
I'm getting ahead of myself. But the first team to 1,000 points wins, and that's the bread and butter mode. There's also Domination, which is like mini Conquest. It's usually a smaller map with less flags. It's more focused on like close quarters fighting, which seems really cool because there's no vehicles in that mode, so you get to, you know, try your
like an infantry focus. Like right, they've exactly. Traditionally always kind of had like an infantry focused only mode.
And then there's Rush, which is it's the same thing, pretty much what I've mentioned on Operations, except you have two points that you have to plant bombs on. They're what do they call them? Beacons?
Telegraphs.
Yeah, and the enemy, the defender, can actually call in airstrikes using them. I didn't actually know that. I think, Kevin, you mentioned that to me.
Yeah, I did. It's odd. I've never actually seen it do it. If you run up to it, it'll say, hey, you can press and hold E to send in enemy positions to artillery, and then it does that, and it says, enemy positions sent to artillery, and then things happen, but I've never gotten like points from it or notifications of kills. So I have no idea what it does.
Oh, so you've actually done it.
I've done it, but I've never seen the fruits of its accomplishment.
If I'm not mistaken, I believe it spots the enemy in a certain area. I'm not 100% sure.
Okay.
That's what I've heard.
Yeah, we haven't really played too much of that mode either. I had a medal for it, so I had played a bit, but again, it's not really what I'm here for. they've got Team Deathmatch, which is basically just, if you just don't want to fight the objective, you want to be that sniper on the hill shooting at people, that's probably the mode for you, because you will definitely not be a detriment to your team in there. And then lastly, there's a mode called War Pigeons, which is actually pretty weird. I had to read about it because I hadn't tried it, because I saw the pigeon part from the single player, and I assumed it related to that in some way, but it's almost like a one flag capture the flag mode. A pigeon coop spawns, so you have to find that and then take the pigeon to a safe area, right? And then it sounds like you're writing the enemy position, and the pigeon goes and tells the artillery team where to fire, and then they just rain fire down on the enemy.
So it's a little bit like Hardpoint from Call of Duty. You guys remember that?
Have you tried it?
Well, I mean, like, I haven't tried it, but like from what you described, that's kind of something it sounds like.
Do you mean Headquarters?
Or what's, is that the one that when the stuff moves around?
Yeah, that's the one thing that spawns, and it's Headquarters in Call of Duty, where there's the one point that spawns it randomly, and both teams try and take it.
Oh, are you talking about Crazy King from Halo, maybe?
Are you talking about King of the Hill?
Crazy King is. The hill moves around. I don't know. That actually sounds kind of neat. I kind of want to try it now that I know more about it. I just kind of made just stupid assumption. But again, you know, we tried to play something earlier and we couldn't even find people playing the other modes.
Yeah, it's weird. I'm not sure if they try and fill servers, like fill empty servers, or if just literally no one playing anything but 64-player operations and Conquest.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, the thing is, let's be honest, Conquest is the bread and butter of Battlefield. I think if you talk to somebody about Battlefield, they assume, I think in a similar way that most people would assume that when you talk about Call of Duty, you're probably talking about TDM. I think with Battlefield, most people assume you're talking Conquest.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's the best mode, obviously.
Well, and there's like one of the things that kind of makes all the different modes interesting is that there's all these different maps that all kind of borrow different parts. They all kind of share this common pool of maps, but the different game modes actually borrow different parts from the different maps. So it's not ubiquitous.
Yeah, when we tried to play Operations, we didn't actually get to play, but it was on the mountain map, and it included like the back portions that were cut out of the Conquest version of the map. So I actually was kind of excited to go into those areas, but we ended up not being able to play it. But yeah, they have a very good variety of environments. They have deserts, mountains, cities, forests. There's a chateau on that map. There must have been a guy in the back that told everyone to attack because it's called Ballroom Blitz, and it's pretty great. Do you guys have a favorite map?
I don't know the name of it, but it's the one with the castle at Point G.
Edge of Empire.
I love that place. Edge of Empire. I love that map.
Oh, okay. I thought you were talking about Foul Fortress or whatever.
Oh, Foul
Fortress. No,
that
one's
the
shitty castle map.
All right.
Yeah, there's a large breadth of castles in this game, but they were not all created equal.
No.
I like any map that's not Suez.
Oh, yes. Oh my god.
Yeah, so should we talk about that? The map balance, you think?
I mean, I played it once and we won. It seemed fine.
Well, generally, I think there's probably, like, I would argue there's kind of like three tiers of map. And I think, like, in terms of like quality, and I would measure there's kind of like two, there's like really an axis, there's like almost two axes there, like balance in terms of the team's ability to like take and hold points. But then the other axis there is kind of like grindiness, which if anyone has been playing Battlefield since like Battlefield 3, even Battlefield Bad Company 2 suffered from this a little bit, but it's really been exacerbated in the last couple of modern Battlefields. Where a lot of the players seem to seek out opportunities for very narrow engagements with extremely high body count. So really focusing on large numbers of players in a very small volume, all shooting across a little no man's land, which is oddly fitting for World War One, but is not a play style I think people in this channel like.
No, I think it's been said before, a realistic World War One simulator, and it exists, it's called Verdun, you can buy it on Steam right now.
Verdun, please.
Oh, I'm sorry. Apologies, I'm so sorry to the people of Verdun. But your town should have been called Verdun. It is just a harrowing adventure of like just mashing blood and bone and running towards an iron curtain of death. It's just not fun. Yeah.
I think the artillery in that game is like more realistic, and that's like what killed the vast majority of soldiers in World War One. Mm-hmm. So that doesn't sound all that fun to me. And but you have bicycles. That would be nice to have in Battlefield.
That would be cool.
Well, I don't know about that because there's motorcycles in Battlefield One, and it handles terribly.
Oh my god.
Yeah, you're probably right.
I think I just don't think they have physics for two-wheeled vehicles because like every vehicle is either like a four-wheeler or has had like a sidecar. No, but so going back to this like three-tier idea, I would propose that probably the like I want to flip the question on its head. So like using these two things, like what's the least balanced and what's like the most grindy? I think to me, obviously the most grindy is probably Argonne Forest.
Uh-huh.
Mm, yeah.
Second only to what's the other one? Amiens.
Amiens, or however that's pronounced.
Well, yeah, I guess you're right. Suez isn't really a grind. It's just seems like there's advantage to one of the sides.
For sure.
Yep.
Yeah, Argonne is just and this has always been something that I've wondered. Argonne Forest, and maybe I'm getting old, and I am, but I have such a hard time spotting the enemy in Argonne Forest, and I have to wonder if that's because I'm playing on high settings, and if I lowered my settings, if like enemy spotting would be easier. And so I'm wondering if like by playing this game beautifully, I'm actually putting myself at a tactical disadvantage because I do not do better. I do far worse on that map than I do any other map. I'm just constantly killed by people I don't see, and it's really hard for me to pick out the enemy on Argonne Forest.
I haven't really noticed it on that map, but I definitely get what you're saying about the graphics, because that's always, it's always funny to me because the pro players, like, they just will turn the graphics down, they'll be like polygons running around, you know, because it increases the readability. But
I think my favorite map without a doubt is the mountain map.
Mount Grappa.
Much verticality is so much fun. I really think it's also one of the most unique Battlefield maps I've ever played. And the points are all relatively fun and satisfying to attack. They all have multiple avenues to get in, even even the ones that are bunkers, they have multiple doors. But Miguel, you have this whole playstyle where, I mean, you could talk about it, where if we're doing bad on a map, what do we do?
Well, what we do is we pick a point and we stick to it and we hold that point at all costs, no matter whether we win or lose, because sometimes you just got to make your own fun.
And 9 times out of 10, we lose.
But that one time we win, oh boy. Oh, man. That's pretty nice.
Well, that map too, like, one of the two, like, emplacement guns is quite bad compared to the other one, which seems weird to me. You'd think they'd be more in line with each other. And also the bunker system, like, locking the doors and stuff, like, you're trying to lock the doors and some jackass just runs out the door that you're just trying to lock, you're like, okay, I'm going to die in this damn seat.
My counterpoint there is I actually kind of think that's cool design in the sense that it takes kind of a weird commitment to stick in that bunker. It's kind of boring sometimes. And it also requires a significant amount of, like, coordination to not sort of, like, give in to that desire to just run away. The other side of that coin being, it's very hard to dig people out of that bunker if they're determined to stay.
Yes, definitely.
This kind of rolls us into sort of a talking point. There's a lot of different classes and kits in the game. There's a few that can handle actually breaching those doors, and only a few.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. On the point of classes, I mean, I think what's really interesting to see over the last couple of years as like different takes on Battlefield have come out, especially the shift in Battlefield 3, which was kind of inherited by Battlefield 4, but then a little bit of toying with the formula in Hardline. We've returned to this kind of concept of four central classes, which really focus on sort of like the four primary abilities that have really been like a long time part of the Battlefield series. And so we see a return to the pure assault. These assault, like, who really focuses on rapid fire weapons, especially SMGs and actually shotguns, and is focused on close up trench style warfare, and really has access to a lot of anti-tank weapons.
Yeah, that's kind of neat that they put some of that on that class. That AT rocket also is just a monster when you body somebody with it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's a better sniper than a lot of snipers, I feel like. it is a beast. I mean, the assault class is really fun. I kind of don't like it because it feels too mindless to me.
I think it's interesting because compared with a class like, say, medic, and a true full medic has made a return, who really focuses on mostly self-loading, so semi-automatic rifles. The shift, like, from hardline, where basically the operator who was the medic would get access to the traditionally kind of soldiery frontline weapons, so your assault rifles in that game, essentially splitting that back out into two classes, I do think gives some pretty significant incentive to play the medic, if only for your ability to stick into a position by reviving people, and just frankly, you know, from a mercenary perspective, the ability to get a lot more points. But obviously a significant disadvantage against vehicles, which the assault does not have.
Yeah, medic is really the only class. Every class technically has a means to deal with vehicles.
I don't think K-bullets counts.
No, K-bullets are actually pretty good because they stop a tank from healing. So if a tank takes any damage when it's healing, true. It stops them, and you can just output K-bullets like a mofo from a range that can actually make it really hard for the tank to engage you back.
But if you run into a tank, but like a full health tank by yourself.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. But that's pretty much every class, even the assault. I mean, honestly, if you're a really good assault, maybe you can manage something. I found that gas grenades and dynamite work pretty okay, or smoke grenades and dynamite, because the smoke obscures the vision, you see. And really any class. Vehicles need teamwork.
Mm-hmm. Yep. When I'm in a tank and those bullets are ricocheting off me, I get scared, man. It's like a psychological thing. So
I'm with you.
Well, Johnny, you're like the tank lord. What to you is the scariest infantryman on the ground? Who's the worst to deal with?
Well, it's definitely the assault. If I like the spot TNT. A building and then I see like three explosive symbols, I'm like, oh, I'm out of here.
So what do they roll with? TNT and anti-tank or what?
The thing problem is like the speed of vehicles in this game is they only go as fast as someone sprints. So if you're trying to run away and someone's determined to get you and you're like rolling away, they can just sprint after you forever and you can't really get away from them.
Well, I mean, there's other the heavy vehicles are kind of slow. That's true. But there's a lot of vehicles in this game that are actually pretty snappy.
Well, I mean, I'm just talking more of like the heavier tank. Well, even the light tank doesn't go that fast compared to like just a regular armored car or something.
It can run faster than a sprint though, because I've been outrun.
Nope. It can't.
Forward? I'm pretty sure it can. I've chased after them.
I've had a tank chase after me. Well, I've had a person chase me across an entire map just sprinting after me.
I think we need to do a foot race here.
Dogfight. Rounding out the three legitimate classes is the support, who is the standard LMG toting individual whose main responsibility is to top up the team with ammunition, and that still plays a strong role. They've gotten access to some weapons which we've seen takes on before, but are very strong in this context. The mortars, which are both the airburst and the high explosive, and have some ability, sort of some medium anti-tank ability with limpet mines and the like. And so actually finds itself as like a pretty versatile class that is, I think, I really credit to any squad.
Much better from the beta 2, vastly improved. And I think it's hilarious that limpets are basically magnetic mines, but they'll stick to anything. So I just throw them up on buildings to clear them out, and you'll get kills now and then. It's really funny when you're just trying to blow a building up and some jackasses inside and gets blown up.
Get a debris kill.
Pretty awesome. They bring down like half a house in one charge.
Yeah. Incredible. And you can resupply yourself too. So.
Yeah. Oh yeah, you just get an infinite supply of the damn things.
And then go ahead.
I was gonna say I wish they threw a little faster, because it is kind of hard if you're running after a tank and they're backing up. Like trying to throw that limpet and actually get it on the tank is somewhat difficult because they fly so slow. I've definitely missed them and then died. And
my heart just goes into slow motion and I hear the Chariots of Fire theme. I'm like, I'm gonna get there. And rounding out is that most scoundrelly of classes.
When played
a little too passively, I think it's been a hallmark of the series is there's a conflict among elements of the player base, the sniper, the scout, and so the sniper's main focus obviously is anti-infantry at a distance. They really focus heavily on lever action and particularly bolt action rifles, both with and without scopes, and they are equipped with something really joined the series and is sort of more of the Battlefield Bad Company 2 timeline, but they have the abilities to use spotting flares to locate enemies within a certain proximity. They have the ability to do some hilarious gadgets which help them snipe, including the sniper shield, which is a little bulletproof shield they can lay behind. And maybe it makes sense for Kevin to tell you about his favorite sort of sniper gadget.
Well, so it is by far the best gadget in the entire Battlefield series to date. You can put a little head on a stick and it'll fool other snipers into thinking there's a guy over there, but then they shoot it and it's just a head on a stick, and then you're like, oh, I'm gonna kill that guy back, but it really doesn't matter because it's a worthless gadget that doesn't do anything except give you 15 points when it's destroyed and it takes up a slot for something that would be much more useful to take.
And it looks dope.
It looks and you get like four of them. You can put a bunch of them out. It's ridiculous. I mean, it's cute, but I like using it like in theory, but it has practically no purpose because honestly, K-bolts are really useful. I know that one-to-one, a K-bolt is pretty much useless, but if you're helping a teammate take down a vehicle, a K-bullet will keep it from repairing and it will keep it critically low. And it can finish it off in a few cases. If you hit all of your K-bullets onto a vehicle, you're going to do 20 to 30 damage, which isn't a lot, but it's nothing to necessarily laugh at. spotting flares, I love the scout or the recon class or whatever it's called. So I could tell you this for hours. Spotting flares they are incredibly useful. I think they're the most powerful tool in the game, honestly, being able to see enemies through walls wherever they are hiding when you're capping a point or taking a point back is just incredibly useful. There's another flare that blinds the enemy, which is kind of more funny than it is useful. And the sniper shield is kind of really only good for pieces of shit who just hang back and snipe, and they're awful human beings.
The impression I'm getting is the best way to run this class is decoys and blinding flares.
Yeah, obviously. You drop a decoy, you blind the enemy, and then you run away so you can get a sweet vantage point.
If they're blind, they can't see your decoy. That doesn't seem like a good strategy.
Well, no, drop it so that when they become unblind, they're like, oh, the guy's right there, and then you shoot your decoy, and then they feel like an idiot. And then they die of shame.
Okay, that's some next level. I didn't think it all the way through. I'm sorry.
Well, I mean, not everyone can be a pro like me.
That is true. That is true. We all strive to be you, Miguel.
Well, I don't blame you.
So there are... the interesting thing is, longtime fans of the series will note, there is no mechanic class. A traditional or engineer class. And so the engineer, longtime standard of the series, oftentimes are the ones giving SMGs, focus really on repairing vehicles. And the reason it's gone is they made what I would argue is a very interesting decision. So both planes and tanks have their own class of pilots, their own classes, specifically pilots and tankers. They have access to their own series of weapons, which is basically personal defense weapons, but of the era. So essentially carbine pistols or machine pistols, and are really focused on keeping their own tank up and running and not much else.
What you said is not entirely true, because a change from the beta that I'm not really happy with is that they gave the support class a repair tool, which essentially makes it an engineer class, in my opinion, because it lets them fix vehicles and do that really obnoxious thing people did in Battlefield 4 where they would just hide behind a friendly tank and stop it from dying.
Sir, I'll have you know that's a 1942 time-honored tradition to hide behind your tank like a baby.
Yeah, I am... There are a lot of changes from the beta that I am very disappointed that they went back on their word. For some that were good, but most really just disappoint me.
Well, let's just all take a moment of silence for the invincible little bird. You can no longer heal a vehicle that you're inside it as a passenger, so you know that's a huge deal.
That's true. Yeah.
And that's good. You still have to exit your vehicle, or you have to be the pilot with a repair tool. Technically speaking, you can only repair a vehicle that you're driving now if you have a repair tool. So you don't necessarily need to be a tanker class. You could be a support class with the repair tool.
Yeah.
But okay. I just want to get into this because it's gonna bother me if I don't say my piece here. In the beta, kills didn't count for score in conquest. The only thing that mattered was territory control because it's an objective game mode. People got upset and they reverted that change, and now kills do count towards ticket loss. And it's just, yeah. I can't understand it. It just seems like such a backwards move for the series. Again, Team Deathmatch exists.
Mm-hmm. I get the feeling that a few famous YouTubers complained about not being able to sit up in a hill and snipe all day and still have good scores, and then I guess the squeakiest wheel got the grease and they made that change. Another terrible change, I think, is that they gave the sniper the tripwire tool instead of the support.
Oh, right.
Yeah,
so
agreed.
That just extra encourages camping more than it did in the beta.
That makes more sense to me, you know, canonically.
It makes sense, but I don't like it.
I agree, but wait, so to that
I'm
point...
I'm much rather have the mortar.
Have you guys noticed that? I haven't really seen tripwires be a major problem.
It's because the people who use... they're too far away. Like,
yeah.
I use them all the time because I play Recon Forward. I use the Martin Henry, the Martin Ellies, and it is...
Oh, the Martin Shkreli, you mean.
Yeah, sorry, the Martin Shkreli.
The Doc Martens.
Yes, the Doc Martens.
There's a gun called the Martin Henry.
Okay, thank you. Yes.
That's a joke.
And it's an amazing gun. It's a breech loading black powder rifle, basically. And it's dope.
In 1918.
It's amazing. And it just fires one fat shot. It is a single shot, but it only has iron sights. But it's really effective. And one thing to note that's really interesting about snipers that I didn't think I really knew this in the beta that I do know now is up close snipers don't one shot hit kill. But after a certain distance, they do. So their damage graph is kind of a hump. They do a lot of damage up close, but not a lethal amount. And then they do a lethal amount to a body shot at like a certain optimum range, and then they fall off again. The Martin Henry's optimum range is very short, so it's really good for kind of close engagement. And so I use a tripwire all the time. I'm constantly putting down incendiary tripwires and getting kills with it. But most of the people who use the scout class sit a mile away with their little scopes, and where are they going to put it? Behind them? No one's going to run up and run up on them. People are just going to counter snipe them or drop bombs on them like I love to do.
Yeah, we were taking the mountain map. We were going up the hill, and like there was literally like one person capping the point. There was two snipers just chilling on the hill just outside the range of the cap. They were just like laying down trying to shoot towards mid, and I'm like, I'm about to lose my mind. Like, all you got to do is stand up and run forward about 10 feet, and you would have been helping the team out so much more. But they're just in their own little world sniping away, you know?
The best thing about snipers is that if you're trying to go for the horse medal, then you just go into cavalry class and run all those assholes over, and you got it.
Yeah, I mean, I've been a bomber before, and Johnny, you gun for me a lot. Miguel, you've also gunned for me quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
Snipers, when I'm on the ground, I hate snipers, obviously, because they're annoying. They don't kill me a ton, but it's enough to be frustrating. But when I'm in a plane, I love snipers because I generally just fly the very big bomb class, which is just like, it's meant for vehicles, but it will kill people. It's kind of hard to hit on anyone moving, but snipers don't move, so they're great. So it's like you just drop these two gigantic bombs, and it's just like a giant fuck you for camping, and oftentimes you guys will sit there and gun them down. It's great.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Did you see the video on Sinai Desert when the light tank went up on the ridge and all the snipers were just like, instead of just jumping off, they like were trying to fight this tank. Every one of them got run over, killed. Like, they just like, I'm not leaving this point. This is my point. I'm a sniper.
The one guy was just trying to like hide in the corner, like, oh, he's not gonna see me here.
If you're like in a bell tower and you want to put a trip mine at the bottom, that kind of makes sense. But yeah, it seems like an issue of clamoring, like the squeaky wheel got the grease, because all the choices in the beta, not all of them, but a lot of the choices in the beta were really good, if not a little bit of a sort of what's the word I'm looking for? Kind of a they you know, it's away from the
regression?
Norm. For, yeah, or not a regression, more of a progression, but it's away from the norm for Battlefield.
Smart choices. Yeah, that yeah they smart backed choices. Out on.
Yeah,
I think that developers should know when to listen to their fans, and you don't want to come off as not listening to them. But man, yeah. Fans are the worst. Remember when the developers of SMNC listened to their fans? Holy shit, they ruined the game.
Oh my god. Yeah. Well, no, and this bothered me. And I don't want to get into a whole thing, but like, you know, on Reddit today, and look, I'm going to date myself horribly, but people were complaining, implying heavily that the modern Call of Duties were like too like silly and colorful. And I can just so easily remember when everyone was complaining that they were all too dour and brown.
Yeah.
So I mean, mm-hmm. like the whole point is that you're always going to have a vocal minority that will get the developer's ear and just like tell them something that most of the players don't care about. I'd way rather have, by the way, I'm not against either one of those. I'm not saying it should be more colorful or less colorful, but like it'll be way cooler if the developer makes the game that they essentially want to make. And I think while this is definitely like, this is a big series, EA has poured a lot of money into this, is a very corporate enterprise look. I'm not saying DICE is a small independent developer, but you get the real feeling from both when they've talked to you know, people in the media and like even when you play the game, that they really cared about making this in like World War One. They really cared about like this setting and a lot of the things unique to it. They poured a lot of love into this, I think. Compare it with Battlefront, by the way, with the Battlefront newest one, which I think was like technically well done, but like had a lot of problems. I think this by comparison shows that like when you let a developer make the game they want to make, there's a reason they're kind of the experts.
Yeah,
Battlefront was rushed too. I feel like that game was just kind of rushed out the door, but I could be wrong.
No,
it seemed like they announced it and then there was like a beta like really soon afterwards and kind of half baked.
It's a really hard balance because you do need to listen to your fans. We're going to be talking about Titanfall 2 a lot coming up here soon because a lot of us are really passionate about that game and we're really looking forward to it. Hopefully we won't be left down, but
we're starting a new podcast called Droppin' Tights, right?
Oh yeah, absolutely. So prepare for Droppin' Tights. They had a technical beta or whatever you want to call it, an alpha playtest, whatever. And there were a lot of people who were very, very adamant that, you know, hey, we're interested in Titanfall 2 because we love Titanfall 1. Titanfall 2 feels slow and clumsy by comparison. This isn't good. And the developers actually address that, and they address it very intelligently. And it's a very hard thing to balance. You know, you do need to listen to your community to a certain extent. But a lot of times, and this is something that most people will kick and scream just simply is not true, but a lot of times gamers don't actually know what's best for them because a lot of people just want, you know, I want what is fun for me. I want what is good and enjoyable for me. I don't want to have to wait for things. I don't want to have to earn things or unlock things or try for things. I want what's easy and fun, and that doesn't necessarily make good balanced gameplay often.
Here's why I think the Titanfall proposed changes were good, and I'll compare them to something I'll consider as bad. The Titanfall changes were specifically speaking to like what the game was trying to accomplish philosophically. We want this to be a game where traversal is important, where speed is critical, where momentum is key, that rewards like that level of skill. Whereas like you compare that with like, well, I want Battlefield to be a game that it's not, which is like solely about kills. Good feedback for either one would be like, oh, I think, you know, the damage drop off on this gun needs changing. That's something they can totally change. But like when you like the kind of feedback the developers should ignore or seriously weigh against is the kind of stuff that's like, well, is this really the game we're trying to make anyways? It's not just an unbalanced gun. It's just like they want to play something different.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I think it's a lot easier in the Titanfall developers' case because I think their fan base is much smaller than the Battlefield fan base, which is not necessarily a bad thing. I mean, there's no accounting for tastes these days. I think Titanfall 2 is a much better game than Battlefield 1.
But how do you don't really know because it's not out
yet. Yeah, I was going to say, it's not out yet. I don't even necessarily disagree with you, but let's...
I know you're there looking at your Funko Pop all playing with it like, oh, Titanfall 2 is the greatest game ever made. It's not even out yet.
Not even ashamed. But I think what I was trying to say is that it's a lot easier for developers to listen to their fans when it's a smaller overall population and they're... I don't know. Less white noise.
Oh, they're all Mensa members, right? All the Titanfall 2 fans. They got their...
Yeah, well, it seems like kind of the master race or...
Oh, no. I mean, there's also the case where there's like a very small community and they want things their way, and that's not always best either. But I'm just saying it's easier for developers to listen to their fans if the fans aren't like people on Reddit all saying they want kills to count again for Conquest.
Yeah.
You're totally right. Especially when you consider if there's like a bummer bomber or execrable like minority of that group, just on sheer volume alone. If like 0.1% of Battlefield fans were wanted shitty things, there's like 100,000. No, there's like 10,000 of those, and for Titanfall it might be like 1,000.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's just such a shame because team deathmatch exists. Go play that if you want to only care about kills, you giant piece of human excrement. Like, Conquest is not about that. It's about teamwork and territory control and objectives.
I mean, I think that's why a lot of these snipers gravitate towards Conquest, because they know that people aren't gunning for them. They're going for the objectives, yeah. So they can get a bunch of easy kills. Whereas if it was team deathmatch, they'd actually have to have some amount of skill to not die all the time.
Oh yeah, I completely agree, which is why I am so happy when I see Johnny in a light tank, because all, like, the snipers are just looking at him like, I can't headshot that, I don't know what to do.
So I wanted to talk about the tanks a little more, because I didn't really use tanks that much in the beta, but it seems like they did nerf the light tank. The heavy tank seems way better now. I think, Johnny, you're like the tank expert, right? So did you want to talk about the tanks? Because I remember you got a match where you were like, what, like 46-0 or something?
It was like 43-0 initially, and then I finally died near the end of the match.
They got so mad too. It was great.
They were screaming racial epithets.
Yeah,
at you.
They called me a racial slur tank. I was like, oh, okay.
I believe the exact term was N-word tank.
Yes, it was an N-word tank. I was like, okay, I don't. All right.
You apologize afterwards, though, in his defense.
He was like, oh yeah, I'm sorry. I didn't want to be racist or anything, but you know.
it's okay, guys. It's cool now.
Your tank. Rampage brought out the worst in him, man, and he felt bad about it.
Unleashed the darkness inside.
Well, I mean, he called you a faggot, but not in a gay way, if you know what that means.
Oh my god! Guys, it's not that kind of a show. Come on. Oh jeez.
Hey, we got that explicit tag.
Yeah, we're okay. Look,
This is World War One. You know, there's no Hitler yet. You know,
that's true. I love all the people being like, yay, like, Hitler won, like, go Hitler. It's like, dude, he wasn't a thing yet. This is World War One. Slow your shit.
He was still an art student.
He was probably one of our soldiers for playing.
Yeah, he was a soldier.
He was a junior officer. And if you actually want to have like a huge what if, like, one of the operations is you play the Kaiserschlacht, which failed in real life, but like if it succeeded, maybe they could have sued for peace and the war could have ended with Germany basically maybe retaining some of the territory.
Well, I mean, it depends on how good their lawyers
were. Did they have
too
many snipers? Is that why they lost?
Yeah, nobody was on the point.
Thanks for listening to David Parker's Hardcore History.
what about these tanks? So you did a howitzer tank. That thing's fucking awesome. I'm so glad you told me about it.
I'm wondering if they're gonna nerf it in the future, because it's ridiculous against like any other vehicle that has armor on it.
And infantry, right?
And infantry most of the time. Like it has a light machine gun, which has a pretty low cooldown, and it just spam bullets at people.
I thought it was a heavy machine gun, because that thing tears through people way more than most other mounted machine guns do.
Yeah, I guess.
I find it easier to kill people, especially at range, because like the canister shot, like that shares the same shot as your main gun.
Yeah.
It takes forever to reload.
It's the main advantage of it. You can reload your heavy gun, like artillery, while you just shoot them with a machine gun. And that's what keeps most of the damn assaults off my back, especially the ability to repair your track and deploy smoke. Mm-hmm. I just do that, run away, repair, and then come back and kill everyone again.
Yep.
What about the flanker? What is the difference in the flanker? Because I didn't even
the flanker. It's like an autocannon almost. So it has a splash damage shell for the main gun, and its secondary fire is sort of like a like an automatic shotgun almost. It's a super fast reload on it.
Oh, that's right. So it doesn't have like a big projectile.
No, it's just like the main gun is just like I said. It's a splash damage autocannon, and it can fight vehicles to good effect. It's just that if you get hit by a big like a howitzer shell or something, then you're screwed pretty much.
Are land ships bad? Because I don't see people using them that often.
Land ships are bad.
It requires good squad coordination.
I think the default land ship isn't that great, because you have like the driver has like a machine gun, the two back gunners have machine guns, and the two side cannons have like the actual artillery shells.
And
but then there's a tank hunter variant, which is actually pretty good. It's only a 3-seater as opposed to 5. Mm. And then you, the main gunner, the driver, instead of having a machine gun, has essentially a recoilless rifle that can do a pretty decent amount of damage to vehicles. And then the two sides have artillery shells.
You have the tank of air, the tank hunter's gun.
Yeah, that one.
Oh, okay.
Isn't, I thought all the landships were 3-seaters except for the support landship.
The squad one, yeah.
I'm pretty sure the default ones, and that might be the support one, but that one has 5-seaters. I don't know what the third variant is.
Yeah, I was surprised to hear that. I thought they were all 3-seaters, so every one of them.
So the mortar, there's the mortar landship, which is the default. It's a 3-seater. There's the tank hunter, which is a 3-seater, and then there's the support one, which is a 5-seater.
Well, so here's the problem with landships, and Johnny is the master of executing this in motion. Their sponsons, their weapons on the side, are quite easy to disable.
Wait, what were they called?
That's true.
Sponsons.
Sponsons.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, like Ron Sponson.
Like Ron Sponson. Okay.
Yeah, otherwise known as a big shooty guns.
Well, a Sponson's technically the little box on the side that holds
I'm going to fall asleep. Stop.
Oh, God. Okay. Miguel, you used to use the AA truck. Have you noticed any differences between the artillery truck?
Haven't gotten a chance to use it that much, but I want to say they added a third variant to that truck since the beta. There was the one that just had the machine gun mounted on it, and there's one that has the AA gun mounted on it, which was my favorite, and then there's one that's the actual artillery truck, and I might be wrong, they might have had that in the beta too, but that seems new to me.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I believe that's right.
It's an okay truck, but if you're taking the artillery truck, you might as well take the howitzer light tank.
Mm-hmm. Well, unless you're trying to shoot down planes, which can be quite a nuisance. And with the AA gun truck, it is very easy and very satisfying.
That's true.
Not to take our chat back too far, but one thing I do want to say is a perfect example of feedback that DICE should not listen to. People are complaining that anti-air is too strong. I disagree.
Oh, no, yeah, absolutely not. No.
Fuck, you can blow up planes. The guns.
Yeah, exactly. Fuck planes.
Yeah.
A regular grenade will basically take out that thing. So just coordinate with your team, but also all planes must be grounded.
I am going to play a slight devil's advocate. I think that, well, actually, okay, so here's the thing. I think that, yes, it is actually probably in a good spot, but there is this really weird discrepancy right now that I kind of want to talk about between land, like tanks and the air. Air has the potential to do pretty good. A good run, and I like to think of myself as a pretty good pilot. I don't know if I'm great, but I like to think of myself as pretty good. A good run for me in a plane before being shot down is maybe 6 kills. Maybe. That's like the high end, the upper limit. 8 if I'm really, really lucky. Okay. A good tank, though, is like unstoppable.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm not sure why that discrepancy exists. I think that both things should be powerful in the right hands. But one is so much easier to do well with, and the other is so much harder to do well with.
I have been scarred by planes ever since Battlefield 2. I mean, they were in 1942, but like high-level bomber play used to be just basically impossible to stop. So frankly, I don't think... I want planes to be glass cannons. I want them to be things that you give to people who like realize that they're gonna get 6 kills and die. That seems good to me.
I think what Kevin is saying is that, I mean, I agree with what he's saying. The planes to me seem fine. I think tanks could use a bit of a nerf. They seem a little too good right now.
I die about 600 times more to tanks than I do to planes. Planes don't kill me that often. Tanks blow my ass up all the time.
Planes can be very annoying, but they're not as like just impactful. Frustrating as tanks.
As it should be.
Yeah, see, I don't know, because like if there is a tank on the ground, and bear in mind too, almost every single map has more land ships, tanks, light tanks, artillery trucks, spawns anyway, than it does planes. There's really only one exception, that is Monte Grappa, which might be why I like that map so much. But almost every other map has more ground support than it does have air vehicles. If air vehicles are being disruptive, honestly, it takes about one person to solve that problem. One person in artillery and an AA gun.
Well, yeah, but you can destroy the guns, and like, there's nobody who with what they bring on their person can even threaten a plane.
I don't disagree with you, but most maps, almost every single point has a gun. They respawn if they are damaged. Technically speaking, if you got an entire squad to small arms aim at a plane, you might be able to disable it or at least get it to buzz away. And
there are multiple AA guns all throughout most of the maps.
They
also
respawn. They respawn if they're destroyed. That long.
And you could even get an artillery, an AA truck, which does. And I, this could be just my head, but I'm almost certain that the AA artillery truck does more damage to the Mount AA because things melt when I use that gun specifically. You can even put an AA reticle sight. You can even put an AA iron sight on weapons.
I love that.
But that doesn't change anything. That
it doesn't.
Weird.
It doesn't
make it any more effective.
It doesn't.
But
the fact is,
more.
If you take a suppressive light machine gun, which are the machine guns with the massive magazines, you can actually really seriously do like 20 damage to a plane as it passes. It's not. Oh, yeah. It's nothing to laugh at. It's surprising.
I mean, why would you do that when you could use the bar, which is amazing? So,
all right, cards on the table. Remove all planes. I don't like air combat. It's the worst.
The planes? Do they really disrupt you that much? I mean, they're fine. I don't think they're really that impactful.
That's the other thing. That's the other thing. Even if they destroyed all of the AA, okay. And I'm sorry. I know. I'm kind of like talking my head off here, but I love flying. So this is what bothers me. Even if you destroy all the AA, even if you give me free reign in the sky, I'm gonna kill 2 people every 30 seconds.
Good.
Okay. Yeah, I agree. Good. Like, I can't even have that much of an impact, even if I'm left completely to my own devices. And most people who fly planes only do it to fight other planes. Okay.
Yeah.
It doesn't affect the land battle that much.
All I have to say is, you know, Fleet just does the MI does the dying, and Fleet just does the flying.
Yes. Don't know what that's from. I agree.
Starship Troopers. Starship come on.
Oh, jeez. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
We got those matching tattoos, and you've already forgotten. I can't believe
that. I was really drunk. Okay.
Johnny Rico. Okay. All I
I'm from Monte Grappa, and I say kill them all.
No, my point is just basically, just to put a bow on it, is that if you're going to make... I think planes are in a great spot, but...
Nerf tanks keep planes in the right place.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. Yep. Literally, that's exactly it.
No!
Johnny okay. Tank Wang doesn't want tanks nerfed. Weird.
I would keep the tank nerf super simple, too. Just like 10% off their health. Maybe 15.
Yeah, I mean, they should be impactful. And I think AT rockets, if people use those more, because the assault really can fuck up a tank. Really. Mm-hmm. I mean, when I'm in a tank, maybe I just suck at it because I'm getting shit on sometimes. I get swarmed and I can't get away from them and they just
Although
blow
sometimes
me up.
It feels like the AT rifle doesn't do that. Like, it only like 14, 15 damage against like heavy tanks and land ships. Which...
It's locational damage. Yeah. It depends on where you hit them.
It does.
Well, okay.
And again, I think another big problem still, for whatever reason, is just that light tanks are still the strongest tank class, which is still kind of a perplexing choice. And I want to say they probably need to tune that.
Do you think that really though? Because
The 360 turret and the ability to move really fast really helps them out.
And not have to rely on other people shooting for you.
That too.
Helps.
In a stand-up fight, they get dumpstered.
Heavy tank, though, I mean, it's perfect for people spawning in and swarming points. I think they might be more impactful in a way because they seem, you know, they're more heavily damage resistant. People can spawn in there, especially with, you know, support tools and heal it. We had, you know, one recent game, we had that heavy tank that just refused to die and was really, you know, throwing a monkey wrench in the works. We actually lost that match by like 5 tickets, and that was probably because of that tank.
It's true. The other tanks can definitely be impactful, but and again, this is all anecdotal. I've never seen anyone go like the 50-3 scoreboards unless they were light tank people.
Hmm.
Yeah,
true.
Yeah,
that's pretty true.
Yeah,
you can be KG and escape if you're good, like Johnny.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The heavy tank is more for applying pressure to a point, not actually like directly killing people.
Yeah, it doesn't really get on the point to cap either, which is probably why you see a lot more heavy tanks kind of get blown up because they're kind of generally in the shit, and a light tank is kind of hanging around the outskirts.
Well, like if you're a heavy tank and you dive into the point, you're just asking to get swarmed and killed.
Yeah.
Yep.
Unless you have the flamer tank.
In glory.
Yeah.
Well, the weird thing is it's, and maybe I'm wrong, but it seems like the light tank has the same health as the heavy and land ship.
It definitely has less.
It has less?
Has less, for sure. And its weak spots are bigger.
You one shot a light tank with the howitzer gun.
Oh my God, yeah.
It's so cool.
You can one shot a light tank with the howitzer gun?
Uh-huh.
How?
In the booty.
That's why it rules, dude.
Wait, with the howitzer light tank, not the stationary
light tank. Okay. No, not the stationary.
Huh.
Yeah, you can shoot like in the rear or something like that.
That's crazy. Wow.
That's weird to me because like it's this howitzer gun in the tank and the stationary one. Why is it not the same damage? It's almost like in the
Behemoth,
the AA gun is like, I was doing, I think, a lot more damage to vehicles. So I was blowing up boats left and right with that stupid AA gun. Yeah. But I don't know. It's odd that it would have different. And you're saying the AA truck, too.
Yeah,
it's different than the stationary one.
It has a little epicness lighter, and if the more epic it is, the more damage it does.
Yeah.
That's weird. It is weird. Speaking of behemoths and things like that, so, you know, in the beta, we only had the train. We now have zeppelins and destroyers.
Yeah. Dreads. Well, technically, yeah, it's a dreadnought, which is a boat.
Dreadnought's terrible. Especially, like, so I got in it and I was in the driver's seat. I decided to switch to one of the gunner seats because I was just so annoyed that no one would ever shoot the boats. And I found out why, because you can't see them, but you can
They're
just
gray
shoot,
on gray.
You can shoot direct. Well, you can't even see them because the boat's in the way, but you can shoot directly through the boat and kill them. So I was spotting and I was aiming literally through the front of the ship. And I was telling the other guy, hey man, just shoot through these boats, shoot through the ship. And we were killing them left and right. We stayed in the water like much, much longer than we normally are, because most of the time those guys don't shoot at it, but it still had no impact. I don't feel like the mega vehicles do much.
Well, the Zeppelin can do a lot because that one can pretty much capture any point at once because it's in the air.
If you have a competent pilot.
Well, yeah, but that's pretty much true of any vehicle ever.
I would say the Dreadnought is the worst, the train is the second worst, and the Zeppelin actually can have quite a significant impact.
On which train, though, because the train in the city map, for instance, is like down in the little bunker.
Yeah.
And the one in the forest, I think, is good, right? I don't know.
You can only capture one point, but it can help. Yeah.
The one on Suez is a joke.
Oh, yeah.
It's just like, oh, I'm out here all the way to the desert.
It's like a mile away from the point.
It's a little bit safer from, like, throwables and stuff, but like AT rockets just rip it up from the city.
That is something we have seen a lot of, is that people will like be very protective of their mega vehicle and like hide it far away from the points. Yep. It's like, I mean,
you're gonna win the battle, but we're gonna keep this thing alive. So, fuck you.
We've got orders coming in from HQ.
Yes, sir. We got home from the fight. Our huge armored train you gave us to win the battle that we were losing, it's pristine.
You know what I'm still kind of bummed out by? Oh, you know, actually, I'm probably being an idiot. I think this was World War II, actually. I've seen images before of a absolutely gigantic artillery cannon on train tracks.
Oh, the Gustav. Yeah. That was
Lost Planet 2.
They did have something similar, but the ones you're thinking of are probably the ones from World
War II. I would be A-okay with a mega vehicle train that is two slots, a driver, and just the biggest cannon in the world that you can imagine.
Okay. Well, what about this? There's a big train, and then it takes four people to operate, but each person has to do each individual task. One of them has to turn the cannon. One of them has to load the shells. One of them has to fire. It's perfect.
I would be A-okay with this.
By the way, it was the Paris gun.
Oh, yeah.
When you shoot the Paris gun, do you drift on the tracks?
Oh, my gosh.
You do multi-track drifting.
Yeah, it's insane.
It also causes you to run in the 90s.
How much teeing does it need? You guys forget teeing? Come on.
Teeing.
Jesus.
Okay.
I heard teeing. Like,
you all don't have your beat butts on. Action.
I'll have you know there's thermal energy. So, by the way, just for everyone, all of our listeners, the game that we're talking about is Lost Planet 2 by Capcom. It's actually surprisingly good. Give it a shot.
It's a very good game, yes.
It's humorous and silly.
It's a very silly...
If you need three other friends in order to play with.
If you have three other friends to play with, yes. Absolutely.
It's not a good game. It's a co-op game.
Yeah, we need to... We really need
to adjust
this.
You play as a man in a robotic bee costume, and you need to fight giant, like, scorpions and tentacle monsters with a gun on wheels.
Yeah.
I can't argue anything you say, but I will say, we have a lot of fun playing bad games together.
Excuse me, can you play Fat Dreadlock Ninja with literal locks in his hair anywhere else?
I cannot fight all the different variants of pirates, no. Not in Battlefield 1, anyway.
Yeah, well, that's a shame.
Yeah, it is.
Maybe the DLC will address that.
Hopefully. So that's something to talk about, right? The game is $60 bare minimum, right?
Unless you get EA access.
Then it's $53.
Yeah.
Bare minimum. Plus $5.
And $60 is the cheapest. Now, that's standard AAA kind of game. I mean, I still think that's kind of getting outrageous in this day and age, but maybe...
Worth it.
No way, dude. The game... Games have been the same price for a really long time. When you
agreed.
Think about it, they should have gone up.
They should have gone up.
So
yeah.
we're kind of, that's why they have to do all this crazy stuff, right? All the DLC, because gamers are really sensitive to that. So they're not going to accept a price increase when, in fact, it's kind of justified.
There is a lot of quality in this game.
I would argue, like, they implemented Frostbite very well. The sound design is incredible. The levels we do get, I'll admit, there's not like a huge number, but there's like 9, right?
Yeah, a decent amount.
I feel like it's a good amount, yeah. We're getting a new one in December as well.
Pretty sweet.
For free.
Sorry, even more of that, Johnny, you played the single player all the way through, right?
Yep.
And I mean, I did. I haven't touched it. I think a few other people have gone here and there. But what are your thoughts on that? Is that worth it?
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty good. There's, I believe there's six separate stories. Mm-hmm. It's not really like a whole linear campaign like the other ones were. So you just sort of, each chapter is about like three to four, each war story, I guess, has three to four chapters in it. Huh. And you just play through that and you just see the story of like one individual slice of World War One.
Huh. I was really interested when I heard about it, but then I kind of got disappointed because it's almost like a glorified tutorial. Like the first one is like the tank and then the airplane and then the heavy, the elite class or whatever. So I kind of lost steam on it, but because, you know, leading into it, I was like, oh, this is awesome. They're going to tell these little vignette stories. It's going to be super cool. And they actually are kind of cool, I guess, still, but it kind of took the wind out of it for me.
I think I really liked it just mostly because of the airplane one. There's a point where you're flying above London, fighting off like a German air raid, and like the music kicks in and you're flying in like formation with all your fighters and everything. And the sun is like coming up above the clouds. It's just like it's a really beautiful game.
Hmm. Yeah, I've heard it's like people are saying it's the most cinematic Battlefield story to date.
They did it. They made smart choices because it would be hard to make like a really long story. I think it's better this way. It's just to change it up so much from story to story.
Yeah, I mean honestly, anything is going to be better than the disaster that was the Battlefield 4 single player. Oh my god.
Oh god.
But wait, you don't love like strong moral choices like does black man die or Asian lady die?
Well, you could just not do anything.
Or yeah, everyone dies.
I mean. That might be more moral. It's like this is a trolley problem.
No, like do I have to hold on to this disaster charge? I can't just drop it, right? I'm just trying to get this straight. Do I need to hold on to it and jump down, or what's the deal?
The insane thing to me with that ending campaign is like, just let me sacrifice myself. Like that's a pretty
that's what
cool
it should
ending.
Have been, yeah,
ridiculous.
And then I could press F to pay respects for myself.
Exactly.
Omar jumps down. They're like, oh, Omar coming.
Oh boy, yeah. The single player looks interesting. I'm really looking forward to playing a pigeon.
The problem. I will say my impression of single player, very similar. I will just simply say that like I wish they had taken it like just one notch further. I feel like in every war story I was like, this is 80% sick as shit, and then it's like missing one more mission to really kind of take it over the edge for me. But like there's like, I won't spoil anything, but there's one story, it's like particularly human and about kind of like, you know, sacrifice, and there's another story that's like potentially has an unreliable narrator, and there's one story that's like focuses really intently on like how cheap the cost of life was. So they take they're interesting takes on it.
I thought it was a bit odd because, man, I kind of forgot what I was gonna say. Give me a second here. Oh, I know what it was. I know
the
what
black
it was.
Protagonist that's on the front of the box is in the game for like 10 minutes
and then he dies.
We're talking about the Harlem Hellfighters constantly though. But the thing I was going to say is the thing that actually kind of took me out of the story mode I played was actually the in-game cutscenes, like looking so much worse than in-game, or the pre-rendered cutscenes. And I just I just couldn't help but notice that every time it happened. So
I actually think that some of the cutscenes like between war stories, I don't know if they took a different approach, but like I think the Gallipoli one looked fine, but like the pilot ones looked pretty bad. So I don't know if that's like subjective, but like I don't know, it's just very strange.
It was they gave that to the interns. Some shined and got the job.
They
and
gave
others.
It to the Battlefield Heroes team.
RIP, it went offline 2015.
Oh no.
It's a wide variety of like different scenes and lighting and everything like that, so it could have just been based off of that.
Yeah, and they just had to do it to mass loading and stuff, and it makes sense, but it just takes you out. It took me out of it.
It is such a good looking game, isn't it?
Oh my god,
it's very nice.
Dude, okay, look, I know that I'm alone in this, but I think Argonne Forest specifically just looks beautiful. The undergrowth is, like, rich. Running through, like, I grew up in, like, a dense forest like that, and it felt, like,
wait,
real.
What?
It was crazy.
Yeah, David is
he was raised
he's
by
a
wolves.
Forest nymph.
Yes, I'm a wild... I'm
you guys
a
have never noticed that when we
man.
Hang out, he's, like, literally a foot and a half tall?
Are you a wild Thornberry?
Yes.
Smash it.
So that's why I like primitive technology so much.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Oh man.
Oh, that's my brother.
Oh, and it's not only the visuals, but like the sound design and everything. Like I believe Matt, when you mentioned the running over shells and everything like that.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, the big artillery emplacements with all these shells on the ground. You run over them. We had a couple people running. Do yourself a favor, get like three guys and run around on those things. It's awesome.
It's a good time, let me tell you.
War tapes is back too. It's awesome.
And then like hearing people screaming and charging at you.
Oh yeah. Oh, when someone runs over a flare, starts freaking out. That's pretty good.
it's like a mix of like almost comical and absolutely brutal too. Like
yeah, like sorry, when you throw a grenade nearby and like as it ticks down, your guy starts breathing harder and harder and more frantically, and it's like really drives home like, oh shit, this guy's afraid to die.
If you're sprinting with the gas mask on for a while, your guy is like, it's just like he's
running ragged, yeah.
It's like horrifying.
I also like the sound effect when you implant a charge and rush. It's a really weird. It reminds me of like BioShock Infinite, like a ringy bell kind of thing.
It does.
Yeah. Oh yeah. There's an elevator like that at work for me.
God, I love all the melee animations. Like they're just so absolutely brutal. You'll like stab a guy in the back. He'll like turn around and be like, "Why?" And then you'll punch him in the face. It's like, oh my god.
That's the best. Like just punching him afterwards. Like you like gut him and then punch him.
I think the one where like you like come up to a guy and like put your knife to his throat and then show him a picture of his parents and say you'll never see them again. It felt a little intense.
There's one where I went down, stabbed a dude. He was a dude who's prone. I stab him in the back and then like straight up field goal kick his head. It's ridiculous. it's just so ridiculous.
Are you sure you weren't playing Duke Nukem?
Oh, I might have been playing Duke Nukem Forever for my fifth playthrough. Yeah, that's true. The Duke never dies. But for all of its polish, there are still an insane amount of frustrating things in the game, an insane amount of bugs, an insane amount of issues.
I think the game actually it feels like the mantling problem. Actually, I haven't noticed as much in their main game. Nope. I think they might have fixed it, but it doesn't seem as like janky and weird. The hit detection seems pretty good,
much better.
I know they're running at like 60 hertz, I think, for the tick rate. So that's commendable, really.
I actually think it's like not quite as buggy.
Yeah, there's still a few things like the bayonetting feels a little more janky than it did in the beta.
Yes,
like
that's true.
Sometimes you'll run over a guy or run past a guy you would have bayoneted in the beta, or sometimes you'll bayonet when you probably shouldn't have or weren't trying to. It's kind of irritating.
Just like real life.
I still personally have mantling problems. I still a lot of times for some random reason
mantling.
I cannot ADS. I cannot look. I cannot turn.
Oh god. If you try to ADS while you have toggle ADS on after you sprint, it won't go. It'll just put your gun back down and they do it again.
Yep, I actually tweeted that to a developer. I put a video up on YouTube. He responded saying that it's definitely a bug and he'll look into it. He's pinged me back for a little bit more information on how to reproduce the issue. So hopefully we'll see a fix for that.
You need to put a suggestion in there related to Sniper so they'll listen to you.
You're right. Shit.
So what you guys are all saying vis-a-vis bugs is 5 out of 5 GOTY, right?
Oh my god. All right. You want to play this game 2 out of 5. That's right.
No,
it was a 4 out of 5. Now it's a 2 out of 5.
Well, okay. We got to think about this, though, because Titanfall is coming out. Will that change the review score at all? Because that should knock it down a few stars.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, honestly, I think Battlefield 1's a solid 2 Funko Pops out of 7.
Titanfall 2 is going to change the game. It's going to be a total reimagination of all games.
If I got Battlefield 1 out of a blind box, I'd be pretty okay. I'd be bummed out that I didn't get the gold-plated BT from Titanfall 2. But
I mean, who wouldn't?
So, look, I don't want to get into like a whole thing, and I think that I don't know if you guys are quite as big of a fans of the Battlefield series as I am. I know, Kevin, you're really into it. Just like briefly, though, I would say this is up there for me, the best Battlefield game of all time. The only two contenders really being 2142, which I just have a real affinity for.
And a Hardline,
well.
Obviously.
And then, well, no. and Bad Company 2, which I think is probably one of the best entries in the series as well. So the fact that it's in that rarefied air, compare that with Battlefield 3, Battlefield 4, Hardline, which was cute, but like, you know, is a real return to form. And to me, very, very encouraging for DICE.
I will say that for me personally, it feels like one of the most balanced Battlefields to date, with the exception being to light tanks still. But it feels very balanced. It's very fun. Almost every class is quite fun to play and has its own uses. It is probably my favorite Battlefield to date, and I think I can say that pretty confidently now that the sort of sheen has worn off.
And yeah, like after going through the Battlefield 3 and Battlefield 4 launches, I think this was phenomenal.
Oh yeah, not really any major issues with connectivity.
I think that's what I was speaking to, like vis-a-vis bugs. Like yeah, like Battlefield 4 was basically unplayable on launch. This has no stupid battle log. It has no like network problems. It worked pretty perfectly.
I also like the battle pack thing is totally different now. It's just skins. It's not like you'll get like a red dot sight for some random ass gun. You don't even know what the hell it is. So like, what the fuck is this thing even for? And now it's just skins. And I guess it's a little less, I guess it's not I'm less fine exciting. With it. It's fine because the other thing was definitely not exciting either. So
it was like, oh, look, another XP boost I'm never going to use.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. God. What's interesting though, or getting an emblem for the sweet emblem maker. What's interesting though is in terms of like weapon attachments is that you can customize a gun, but for the most part, they've actually kind of ripped away the customization and just turned it into its own separate gun, which is really odd.
Yeah.
I like that.
Not sure I like that.
And the problem with customization is you can't do it in the main menu or anything like that.
Oh,
you have
to do it
in game.
Okay, so apparently this is so I looked into this. This is like a very, very commonly requested thing. Apparently it's in the game, but for whatever reason is not like, it's like on a feature flag. I don't know why, but it's going to be added.
They want to push that companion app, bro.
I guess they really do want to push
downloads.
You can get the desktop companion, or the web or the mobile companion.
The implication I heard was that it was like bug related, but hey, you know, maybe I'm not cynical enough. It could be the case. They want you to download those sweet, sweet companion apps.
I'm pretty sure that's a good reason why like people haven't used some of the other tank variants is because they can't unlock this stuff without losing the tank slot.
Well, you can though.
Dude, a lot of people don't realize that as soon as you click the tank slot, you're reserved in that tank, even if you're not spawned yet.
No. If you try to go to customize, you lose that slot.
Oh,
really? Are you sure? Really?
Yeah.
I'm confident.
Oh.
Okay. I didn't know that. That does suck. And there are a lot of people who aren't using the variants. That's true.
The answer is just get an iPhone. God, guys.
It works on Android too.
I totally would. I would be super hard pressed to believe that they wouldn't add it eventually. They just clearly didn't have it ready for launch. And it is a frustrating thing, but it's not the end of the world once you realize how it works. And I used to hate how few the war bonds seem to be, and they're actually the higher level you get, the more war bonds you get per level. So now I'm like swimming in war bonds. Mm-hmm. So you know, it's a kind of a slow progression. I still kind of don't like progressions and like gameplay progressions in games like this. It's that still bugs me. That's a point I've talked on forever. But it is very forgiving.
Yeah, I think you're bouncing around in a lot of classes too. Like I just kind of stuck with support for the most part, and I was never want for war bonds.
Yeah, yeah. I mean the best class is the Martin Henry, or the not. The
oh,
Martin.
That's a class. Wow. Okay. that DLC? Did you pre-order? What's the deal?
Oh my gosh! Can we talk about that price real quick?
I mean the $130 version that didn't even include the game.
Yeah. So,
well, that was the like Premier Extreme Stupid Edition. It literally said you're a dummy. If you
you're a dummy, and now you can fly as a Red Baron. Congratulations.
And then you can fly around in the bright ship that literally has an audio DLC that says, I have too much money.
Matthew was mentioning it would be great if you could customize bomb drop sounds. Like, or was that David. You, David?
That was,
David.
That was me. That was me. I wish I could take
credit for that.
when a bomb was going to be lethal on you, it would go, instead of going like, ew, just go, fuck you.
Stop camping. David, you did buy the expensive version, correct?
All right. Okay, so
I don't mean to out you like this, but
welcome to this church basement. I am a Battlefield Premium aholic. My name is David, and I have a problem.
And how much did you spend? Just tell everyone. If you don't talk about it,
I believe it was $115 with the EA Access discount.
Okay, and that gives you access to all of the DLC.
Yes, that's all the DLC forever.
All this like DLC that's not even out yet. This theoretical DLC.
Okay, but to be fair, okay, look, I'm not going to defend it too hard, but I will say that for Battlefield 4, they released like 6 expansion packs, which were all pretty dope. And I'm going to be honest, like a lot of the affection that the rest of these knuckleheads feel for Titanfall, I generally feel for Battlefield. And so I'm optimistic. And I'm also the problem with America. So you're welcome.
Oh, what's this? Beep, 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 beep. Guys, I just got a telegraph. EA is shuttering DICE Studios, and it looks like no DLC will ever be released. Oh,
they have released all their DLC for Hardline, so I'm pretty sure this game's going to get a DLC.
Oh, yeah, totally.
And let's be fair. Me and you, we're both Hardline Premium members, so we didn't do it.
I also had Premium Hardline. It's not something I'm proud about.
Yeah.
Oh my God. I'm the only smart one here.
Let he who is without sin.
Johnny has two skills, tanks and not buying stupid bullshit.
I'm the worst at that. I bought Google Glass.
It says Funko Pop Google Glass.
Oh, man.
Fair enough.
All right, guys. Battlefield 1 is a first-person shooter developed by DICE and published by EA. You can pick it up now on Origin for $60 if you get EA access. You can actually shave a little bit of money, and then you can cancel that immediately. A little pro tip there.
Cancel that.
I'm the greatest.
Or you can be a dummy. You can spend $100 billion on the game and get DLC that may or may not exist.
Jump on the train. Woo!
Or you could just not buy it and save money for Titanfall 2.
I have you know it's called an investment.
Guys, from all of us here at our round table, thanks for listening.
Bye.
Keep sniping and keep not flying planes.
Room tone. In a world where tiny spaceship. Oh, tiny spaceship. This just in. Tiny spaceship. Another thrilling adventure with tiny spaceship. Most of those are jokes. Enjoy.